So I'm going to start with the application. How? Why do you even want to go, which we've covered. Now, you know, when you know you want to go for a foreign LLM, you start with where do I want to go. You look up websites which provide for comprehensive information on what law schools provide which LLMs. There's one called LLM Guide, which was the oldest. And it's good enough, comprehensive enough, but that's not enough. Once you've identified which are the decent universities you might consider applying to, you go to their websites. Yes. And look at every single course. And that doesn't just mean go to the first homepage and see, oh, you know, there's an LLM, great, I want to apply there. You go look at eligibility, you look at the courses they are offering, who teaches those courses, do you like that person's profile, do you really think the course that they're offering suits your expectations, the life that they offer on that university, what are the work, what is the way, if you want to get a work visa, or if you want to get an employment, how will that law school, their career services support you? This is one of the considerations which you might want to look at. These are basics. Then most universities in the US, they use this LSAC, Law School Credential Assembly Service. You have to take a subscription separately. It's free in the beginning. Those guys host the applications for most law schools, except I believe Howard, whose application process is separate in the US. So you use their website to apply. They have their own separate application portal, and that's how they function.
Netherlands also have a separate application portal.
I'm sorry?
Netherlands also have a special...
Yes, I'm talking about the US only for now.
The US and like another country, Netherlands, okay. Where you cannot apply to...
Universities directly.
Yeah.
Okay.
You have to like log in a particular portal and then to either Amsterdam Law School or Latin Law
Tilburg,
School.
Tilburg, yeah.
Utrecht or Rotterdam, anywhere. You need to apply through that only.
Okay, that's good to know. So one of the other universities, is one of the other countries is this. What LSAC for the US does for you is it's a portal. You go to, you select what your relevant law schools are. You open your account there. You start with your application. Now what LSAC will take money from you for is processing your English language test results, which will be TOEFL. Most people take TOEFL. Then it'll also help you process your transcripts from your law school. Now all these law schools in different countries have different way of grading. Now you send your transcript to LSAC, it'll compare you to other to your law school's way of rating you or grading you, and then it'll give you your transcript a specific ranking: very good, excellent, outstanding, average, below average. And these are the comments that'll go along with your transcript to the law schools. So that's one very big help they're doing for the universities and you together. Other thing that they do is also process your LORs, which are letters of recommendation, which are sent in hard copy to LSAC by you or your recommender in a specific format that they provide you. And they will process it and transmit it after figuring out that they are authentic copies of what you say are the LORs. And that's the process for recommendation. This is the only part that LSAC plays. After your application and the payment of fee, of course. At the end, you have to pay fee for every single application that for
original
the law school.
Hard copies or the
original hard copies. So what LSAC has is it's a little tedious. You have to provide them the name of the recommender, what law school you're applying for, assign a code name to that recommender. And then there's a sheet that comes up. It has your name. It has a declaration signed which says that this is an authentic copy, I'm sending it here for this law school purpose. And there are a lot of disclaimers, like confidentiality, privacy, etc. And then you sign at the bottom of it, and your recommender also signs on the bottom of it. You put that along with your recommendation, fold it in a certain way, put it in an envelope, seal it. It has to be sealed with a stamp and a signature of the person sending it. And that's when it's posted. So that's a process you will adopt for LSAC. For them to actually say, yes, your recommendation is authentic.
Is it difficult getting these things done from your bosses, actually?
No, everybody does that. If somebody gives a recommendation, they might as well be very happy to do it for you. That's something which you will consider for the LSAC. See, I'm going to be very honest about this. I think these technical procedures, if you're not doing too much with your time, should not take you more time. And unless you have money to spare and don't have any time, I'll recommend doing it on your own. If you and instead investing it at a place where they're required. For example, what you really need somebody's help on is on the content and not on these formalities, because these are very, very simple. Once you get a hang of it, you're literally at the top of it. It's just pressing buttons, getting a printout. You anyways will have to carry those printouts to your recommender, get that signed. that agency is not going to do it for you. So that's my personal view. If you think you don't have time, you're really tired, you work say 20 hours a day, then definitely go for it, because applying for LLMs and doing all of this takes away a lot of your time and energies, and you need your brain free and thinking to actually write the application. So possibly that. Now coming back to the question again, when you apply to the UK universities, all UK universities have their separate application process. Go to their websites, see what they do, if you want to really apply there, and open your application account on the portal. And yes, start answering the questions. Every university ideally will require you to fill up their small questions in their own applications, basic details, a statement of purpose, the length of which will vary from university to university. The content will also vary. That you'll have to check out on their websites, what they really want you to write. Letters of recommendation, few require two, most require two, few require three. And the third one's usually an option, so you could get away with that. Few of them also require you to answer questions in their applications, which I just mentioned, regarding your influences, expectation. Yes, that's a legal essay. That's an essay. A Harvard and Oxford application, I'm sure, requires it. Now, what you need to also consider is scholarships. A lot of scholarships will not require you to write separately, but just mention you want that scholarship. A lot of them will require you to submit a separate application with separate LORs. So you have to be a little careful with that. The timelines will be very different. At times, timelines will be very similar. So something you really need to take a catch on. So the first step to actually wanting to apply for an LLM is deciding you want to do an LLM. For what cause and for what reason, how will it help you, is your personal reason, but you need to be very clear about it. Choosing your law school after having gone through all of these issues, then figuring out what the timelines of these law schools are. Make a table, write the list of the law schools that you have and the deadlines. Those deadlines need not be the same for the letters of recommendation and the application process. That's something you need to check. If there's a scholarship that you have to apply for along with that law school application, that will be a separate column in your table where you'll write the scholarship's name and their last dates. Scholarships are more important and more difficult to get than admissions anywhere. As a matter of fact, Indians get a lot of scholarships everywhere, every law school, in the US or UK. UK has more scholarships available because of India-UK relations. And this year, since the work visa requirements will be eventually, relaxed. Right, they'll be relaxed. I don't think the final notifications come in yet. Yeah, it's a high probability, but the final notification. Right. So we can look at that. Scholarships in the UK, you can look at the Commonwealth scholarships, definitely. The law school scholarships itself, INLACS, which is an Indian scholarship. You should all look for Chevening also, because Chevening requires 2 years of work ex, but it's a good scholarship and it requires leadership capabilities and potentially having exhibited being a leader in a field. DAD is a good scholarship, that the government of Germany scholarship. The US has Fulbright now, which you can apply to. Columbia has a lot of scholarships for everyone. That's one law school to look at. NYU has good scholarships. Harvard does not have very good scholarships for Indians, but they do give a tuition waiver up to 40%. That's something to look for. I've never heard of any Indian get more than 40% in the last couple of years. That's something you'll need to consider. There are a lot of external scholarships that you can get. KC Mahindra is one. Narottam Seksaria is one. Then a lot of them. Tata's. Sorry? Yes, that's an endowment. You will have to apply, they'll call you. But these are not big scholarships. The big scholarships are INLACS, Commonwealth. There's an Oxford Cambridge Society of India scholarship also. But that's also not a big chunk. So if you really want to go for your master's, have a great application and an admission to one of the best schools, you might be able to raise good funds for yourself. And ideally, if the law school gives you some scholarship, the external scholarships become easier for you, because the law school has reposed so much trust that they want to waive your fee. Definitely somebody else would want to repose that trust in you. Yes, it depends. If you have a full scholarship, everything's covered, you might get the scholarship, but you'll not get the money. So it's as simple. All of these scholarships are run by trusts, which are charitable, so they also have their own legal requirements. You can't get more money than you require in the end.